All right, well, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for joining me for another segment of Lifting Community Spirits. I'm your host, Fred Holley. I'm the event coordinator at Republic National Distributing Company in New Orleans, Louisiana. For those of you joining us for the very first time, a little explanation of what Lifting Community Spirits is. It's a weekly happy hour where I share cocktails and conversation with a diverse group of New Orleans professionals, specifically in the hospitality and food service industry. We're going to discuss the status of the industry from their perspective and get their take on bringing New Orleans to greater culinary and hospitality heights. Today, we're filming from Andrea's restaurant and specifically in his Capri Blue Bar. So I'd like to thank Andrea and the whole staff here for obviously providing fantastic dishes and the setting. Our guest today, I would think no one knows more as to what's going on in the state of Louisiana within our restaurant and hospitality industry than this gentleman. And I'd like to welcome Mr. Stan Harris, the president and CEO of the Louisiana Restaurant Association.
Thanks, Fred.
Thank you for joining us.
Absolutely. Cheers. Cheers, sir.
And as always, we cheer. That means we get to eliminate our masks. And at the end of our conversation, we will have Andrea's wonderful bartenders, Megan and Chris, explain step-by-step each cocktail that we're having. And I do believe Stan is enjoying a Fernet-Branca cocktail called Amaro Andrea, coincidentally named after Andrea. And I'm having a Disaronno Sour. So, to explain the dishes, I'd like to bring in real quick Chef Andrea. Welcome, Chef.
Hi, Sam.
Welcome, Chef. Good to see you.
What a pleasure to have you in my home. My home is your home, as usual. We love to have you. Glad to see you. And by the way, I tell you something that Amaro Andrea, that's absolutely mamma mia.
Fantastic.
And what I'd like to introduce, Stan, you're doing a great job. I thank you so much for all your wonderful hard work you do here in our Louisiana restaurant.
It's our mission.
You're doing a great job. And keep up the good work. Fred, thank you so much for being here.
Yeah.
And show these wonderful dishes. As you know, I always like quality, consistent service. The fish got a shrimp to my door, as you know. We have some beautiful eggplant crab cake, Andrea. That's my, I guess, favorite dish. I created a dish several years ago. It's simple, elegant, eggplant, fresh eggplant. We take the inside and make a wonderful sauce together with the Louisiana crab meat. And then jumbo lamb on top, light lemon butter sauce on top. Mm. And over here we have this beautiful chopino. It's all kind of fresh seafood, shellfish, speckled trout in there, Louisiana shrimps, crab meat in there, and with a little calamari, mussels and clams, light tomato broth. Absolutely, mamma mia. Now when it comes to meat, osso buco milanese, cremolata milanese, we serve with the risotto, saffron risotto at Andrea for many, many things. We opened for the last 36 years. One of our guests' favorite osso buco. I guess is, Andrea, you have the best osso buco in the city. As you know, Fred, I guess I was right.
No question about it.
On my right, we love beef. America's got probably the best beef in the world. I've been all over in Argentina, South America, Latin America, everywhere. But when I came to America, we have the best beef. There's a beautiful 9-ounce beef tenderloin, and we paint sear saute, and it's got a little touch of cognac, onions and garlic. It's got Louisiana fresh shrimps, utensils, it's a jumbo shrimp, green bell pepper, a little touch of demi-glace sauce made from scratch at Andrea. And we flame everything, but we'll touch a red wine, demi-glace sauce, and it goes on top of the beef tenderloin, and it's absolutely magnificent. Mamma mia.
Can't wait to get a bite of that.
And then also we have our guest favorite happy hours at Andrea, the cheese and imported meat from Italy, salami, mortadella, prosciutto, all kinds of cheese, fontina cheese, we have a brie cheese, we have a grana padana reggiana cheese, we have some wonderful goat cheese, and of course comes with a wonderful red pepper jelly, a little cracker on the side. And it's mangia.
Fantastic. Well, thank you very much, thank Chef Andrea. I certainly appreciate you coming
over
to describe everything.
Thank you so much for the opportunity for your company, and we appreciate continuing our legacy for all the wonderful years with you. Thank you for all your support.
Thank you.
Cheers.
Thank you. Cheers again.
Cheers.
Yeah, terrific. Well, Stan, let's get busy because I know that the people watching certainly want to hear what's the latest and greatest. And I think my first question would be in regards to the priority during this pandemic, what the LRA is doing about the situation.
This started for us in early March. And we were at a meeting at the governor's mansion with a lot of tourism and hospitality folks talking about what was going to happen. And we didn't, I would love to go back to our suggestions back then to where we are today, mm-hmm. because it happened very quickly. And we tilted our entire organization forward to make it available to anyone. We didn't put anything behind a pay window. We were saying we're going to serve our industry best here. And it's about information, timely information, accurate information. There were a lot of things going on at that time that people just didn't know, because we were embracing this like we've embraced other natural disasters. The water will rise, the trees will fall, we'll get them picked up, we'll replace and fix the things that need to get fixed, the water will go away and we'll reopen again.
Right.
Unfortunately, this is one we can't really see. We know it, we see the head counts, we see the unfortunate deaths that have occurred from this, but what we've been focused on is how do we keep our industry connected? How do we get them the right information? And how do we connect to those decision makers, whether they're in the governor's office, the Department of Health, Alcohol and Tobacco Control, the State Fire Marshal. The Department of Health has been a critical partner, as has been the State Fire Marshal and ATC, in helping get restaurants open. And I want to compliment the governor on trying to bring consistency and project a feeling of let's do this the right way so that we don't have to go backwards. So it's been a real challenging time for our industry, but at the same time for us as an organization, I think the LRA has risen to the occasion as we do every time we're challenged. And it's a member-specific, member-centric organization, but as we've done since early March, it's for everybody in the industry.
Right. Well, that's very important. Well, certainly you said a word, consistency, and I wanted to ask you in regards to parish. You know, sometimes the message can be different from parish to parish. How does the LRA, or how do you get out a consistent message to the industry when, say, one parish is being stricter than the other?
Well, let's talk about one just a little bit maybe a mile from us here in Orleans Parish, where it can be a little different of a challenge.
Right.
We know now that if the governor relaxes something, the mayor is going to look at it about 2 weeks after. That has been their pattern here in New Orleans. We listened to the Office of Health Director here, Dr. Avegno, today, make some comments about the Labor Day holiday that'll be right around the corner. I think that when we look at these things, we have to ask the questions, why? Why are we doing this? You know, we advocate for restaurants, bars, entertainment venues, nightclubs, all of those people that are trying to stay alive right now. When I say stay alive, keep their business alive.
Right.
Because these are industries that live off of cash flow. You know, when we talk about our restaurants like Chef Andrea's here, 20%+ of his business is in private dining. That's non-existent right now because you can't have large groups. He couldn't do a sellout right now. Those are things that they've taken those opportunities away. They haven't done it on purpose, but they really didn't understand the business model. So if you look at the restaurant industry as a rule and you try to take it at a simple level, you know, it's a 30% food cost and cost of goods, it's a 30% labor cost, and then 30% fixed cost, and maybe you can make 10% or less, but that's how it works as a model. If you lose the top line of revenue, the fixed cost percentage just becomes higher. You may end up with your fixed cost being 50 or 60% of your revenue, and then you're left with nothing. So, you know, if you're a quick service restaurant that's typically not going to serve alcohol, that restaurant can move it all to the window, and they can do 80, 90, 95%. Some quick service places are doing more business than they did before. Our full service restaurants are really struggling because there's a lack of demand and we're not able to congregate like we normally do. When you and I would see each other, we'd sit at the bar, we'd have a drink, we'd have a great cocktail, we might have something to snack on. Today, we're socially distancing, we're wearing a mask, we're doing all of these things that are out of what we would normally do to relate to people that we have friendships and relationships with.
Yeah, it's certainly strange in that respect, and you know, certainly part of this this whole series is educational, but I've had no one turn me down in regards to wanting to get together and talk about it and seeing how we can better the whole situation.
Look, we also have a system that's highly regulated. So our industry, whether it's beverage alcohol or food safety or anything else, mm-hmm. those have processes that you have to follow. Right. So one of the things we wanted to educate the governor's team on was a bar that had an LDH food service permit. Right. Well, when they said early on, a couple of weeks ago, that we were going to close the bars and those with food service permits, then our action became, let's work with ATC and see as many of those as we can get a restaurant conditional permit. Because it's been in statute for a long time. It's not something that normally would happen, but the governor has given direction to ATC to be as liberal in applying this as possible. You've got to have that LDH food service permit. But when you become a restaurant, if you've been a bar and you're one of those parishes that still allow smoking, you can't have smoking in the restaurant time. So again, there's another rub because you're not a bar anymore. Right. You're a restaurant conditional. Yeah. So for me, it's an education process and trying to explain how this works. But I would tell you that there's probably been 200 that have converted, and there'll probably be some more. And we're, as I was walking to the meeting today, I was talking to the ATC office about a couple of our hotel members that had some questions about what they can and can't do. Mm-hmm. That's what we do. It's easier for us to make that connection. It's easier for us to get that information. And at the same time, I also am doing it protecting that identity of that operator so that that operator doesn't feel like there'll ever be any compliance issue that comes their way just because they asked a question. We've got a great ATC commissioner. We've got a great state fire marshal. The folks we deal with in sanitarian services at LDH do a really good job of communicating with us. And if we're going to be the industry of food safety and responsible vending of alcohol and all the rest that we do, then we have to have those relationships.
Well, I'm convinced of one thing, that even though that the majority of people within this industry are out of business right now, I'm assured that you're the hardest working guy right now in this industry. You know?
As my wife says regularly, she goes, you spend a whole lot more time now doing this, but if we don't do it now, we've got to make sure there's a tomorrow.
Right.
And I know there's going to be a tomorrow. I serve on the board of New Orleans and Company. We had a bill in the legislature that got shot down, unfortunately, the last day of the session, that we had gotten an appropriation push through of about $15 million that would go to our tourism promotion authorities. We need that because right now we've got to save 2021. Corporate meetings don't just happen. Association meetings don't just happen. Trade shows don't just happen. And those shows that we've lost this year that may come here every 3 to 5 years, we're not getting them for another 5 years. They're not going to cancel next year to come here. Right. So we've got to make sure that we're aligned with that. We've got to make sure the communication with the mayor's office about group events and large events is important. And of course, you know, in the typical New Orleans fashion and Louisiana fashion, when we were winding down in March and April and the stay-at-home order came out, we took all that business from the spring and we moved it to the fall. And now we've lost it for the fall. Yeah. So that opportunity is never going to replace itself. You know, it's kind of like a hotel. If you don't fill that room tonight, you don't get it back. Same with a restaurant seat. Yeah. So we've got to figure out ways to get everyone to understand in the appropriations model that we've got to prop this industry up because our promotion comes off of hotel taxes. And if we don't have people staying in hotels, we don't have any of that money to spend.
Right. In regards to permits, you had mentioned where you were converting temporary bars into restaurant permits. Is there special permits that the restaurateur would need to get to have outside dining that they do?
You know, that becomes a local issue for zoning. For example, in East Baton Rouge Parish, we worked with Mayor Broom up there to allow for outdoor dining. And part of the thing that we did with the outdoor dining was it's not allowed. Your license for your alcohol is the footprint of the public area of your restaurant. But she, through emergency order, said, because it's an ordinance and she's the mayor, we're going to set that aside. And if you want to do outdoor dining, you want to put a tent up in your parking lot, we're going to give you the opportunity to do that. We've had very good results. We've had it in Lafayette. We've had it in Baton Rouge. We've had it in Shreveport, right. Really around the state. Nick Hunter, our mayor in Lake Charles, they've reached out and said, how can we help? because they understand that the industry is about three or four things. Not only is it about sense of community, but it's about providing those jobs and providing that tax base that comes into those communities, mm-hmm. and offering people kind of some sort of hope that we're going to get through this. So, you know, when I see a restaurant that's pivoted to offering family meals and doing those types of things, we just ended up with a large project for mass feeding for a contract with the city of New Orleans and FEMA under Revolution Foods, put together a group called Chef's Brigade. About 45 restaurants was providing food every day. It was going to typically people that were homebound that weren't receiving SNAP benefits. And they stood it up quickly in about 2.5 weeks. They solved the entire month of July. We got it extended for the month of August. This is keeping restaurant people working during those non-peak times in the afternoon or early in the morning where they can prepare these meals. The restaurants get a little bit of revenue off of it, but it builds that sense of community that we're all working together to get through this.
Well, I'm really amazed at the sense of community in regards to the restaurant out in Kenner, Gianduce's, that went up in flames a few weeks ago, and how the whole industry came together, and he's now in a new location, and he has a future. And so that's something to say about our industry.
Our industry is the backbone of each of their communities. You know, there's not a fundraiser that happens that doesn't happen with our alcohol wholesalers and distributors, right, or our restaurants. We're the people that they call first. We're the people that are providing the food, providing the service, providing the experience. So people will come and be charitable and be philanthropic and do that. And like you, we get invited to those events, seems like every day before COVID. Yep. But at the same time, those needs still need to be met.
Right, right. So tell me in regards to strategy or advice for restaurateurs that are questionable right now, what advice could you give the restaurateur to best hang in there?
Think differently. Get out of the fact of how we did it before. Get out of the fact of how we recovered from the oil spill or how we recovered from a hurricane. Mm-hmm. You know, in New Orleans, they just announced that if you have a sidewalk permit for outdoor dining, that you can get a grant to make your situation more permanent right now. It's a couple of $1,000s, but we're working on that with the city. We're working, as we told them, if you want to expand it, then you need to improve your process of how you get one of those sidewalk permits, right, because it needs to happen quickly because this money will go very quickly. But innovate, look at things differently. When I say differently, everything you do differently. Look at your menu composition, look at what you have to do as far as executing that menu. You may not have the number of staff people that you need to be able to do some of the things traditionally. And at the same time, we tell that consumer, be a little patient, understand that everybody's under a little stress right now, it's a little different. Let's show what we like to call COVID courtesy and move forward with talking to people a little more respectfully and understand that they may not have your favorite every time, but they really want to get back to the time where they can welcome you, your family, because restaurants are all about generating memories. It's not just a special occasion. A memory might be a Tuesday. You know, I have a friend that used to eat with me at my Ruth's Chris restaurant in Baton Rouge all the time. And he used to tell me, I'm here every day that just ends in Y. That's my celebration. Right. So it's what we do. We know that when you look at Chef Andrea, as long as his restaurant's operated here, he's probably on his third generation of families that come here for every celebration, for Mother's Day, for Father's Day. Right. They come here during the Christmas season. They come here when they have a milestone in their life because this is part of their family. This is part of how they look at this. And Louisiana, the thing that I love most about this, and having been in the restaurant business for a long time and doing this now for 10 years, I always say this, no place else do I ever go that people talk about at lunchtime what they're doing for dinner tomorrow, right, or tonight, or how they plan that out. And we're never thinking about you know, well, we've got to find the newest and greatest. We blend everything together. And the coolest part about our industry is that there's always going to be someone that thinks they can do it better. They may be doing it, you know, right across the street from each other. I look when I walk down the 100 block of Bourbon Street, we've got two Brennan family restaurants that sell seafood on opposite corners. That's gotta be very interesting when you have a family get together.
Right, right. Well, that's for sure. You know, I when I interviewed Ian McNulty, I think he made one of the statements that really stuck with me in regards to New Orleans and the region, the fact that this industry and food in restaurants is ingrained more in our culture than pretty much anywhere else in the United States, in that we will in fact come back quicker from this pandemic than any other city because of our culture.
I did an interview yesterday with an advertising company about a rebranding of another enterprise. And one of the things that I talked about was that fabric that keeps us all together.
Right.
It's the fact that we're always the people, if you're tailgating, that says, come on by and grab a drink, come on by. And then that just becomes a thing that they do every year for the next 10 years. You don't even know their name, but you just know their face, right? They just, they become a friend by association.
Yeah.
And there's nothing quite like that. And I think, you know, when you think about the places iconically that we have that are closed right now, and those places that are operating on a limited schedule or a limited seating capacity, they're trying to deliver the same type of experience. And it's tough right now because you're strained under being able to generate the dollars that you really need, and everyone's just trying to hold on. And that to me is what makes us work harder, because we're your advocate. We're the people here that are, you know, we've got direct lines to the governor's office, direct lines. And it's hard for me to have to tell someone no, or that they're just not going to do this right now. Mm-hmm. And it's not the answer I want to give them, because I want to say, yes, that's a great idea. Because most of them are great ideas.
Right. Right.
You know, last week in East Baton Rouge Parish, we had four bars that had brought a complaint that said that they were being unfairly discriminated against. There's 34 more that filed an action in federal court. I don't know if they'll prevail or not, but you know, my answer to them is, what can we do to help you provide the best information so that you can state your case and see what you can get done? But ultimately, when it comes down to it, it's going to involve the governor's team, ATC, it's going to involve LDH, the fire marshal, all of these different people. I'm fond of saying something I remind people about. I ask them, I say, how many people like government? Nobody raises their hand. Right? And they go, I don't do politics. I said, really? Okay, well, let me explain to you this. If you're licensed, regulated, or permitted, government's already inside of you.
Right.
And it's going to wake up like a dormant virus at your weakest moment. That's what associations exist for. That's what we're there for. We're there to help you navigate that.
Well, I know you're doing a tremendous job and tremendous work ethic. I know that you're having right now. And before we dig into these delicious and delectable dishes here, I wanted to ask you one last question in regards to the LRA Educational Foundation. I understand that you're the national chairman.
Yeah, I am blessed. I'm the first state restaurant association person that did this, but I really believe that training young people for the future of our, are the future of our industry. And we have a program that we've had in over 50 schools every year since I've been here called ProStart. And ProStart is a two-year curriculum that teaches either culinary or management skills. In Louisiana, we have another program called Jumpstart that takes young people in high school and allows them to move to a career without having to go to college. And ProStart is part of that. So being able to create that opportunity for them to come in, and then our association wraps that around with scholarships and activities that give these people a pathway to do internships and other things where they go into the industry. Because we explain to them, maybe being behind the line is not for you. Maybe being a manager is not for you. But we have an amazing supply chain. We have an abundant use of people that supply, like Republic, in what they do in supplying the industry and educating the industry on product and how to better do things. There's a huge supply chain that wraps around what we do. So what we're trying to do is create that image that we're here to make it better for the people that come behind us. One of the things I'm most proud of is our team in Washington came up with an idea of helping restaurant employees. And this was early on in the pandemic. And in less than 10 days, we raised $23 million with Guy Fieri as our spokesperson going on doing this restaurant employee relief fund. We've distributed all the money in $500 grants. We've stood it down in about 2 months. The first day we had 60,000 people apply.
Wow.
But the cool part about that is 13,000 individuals gave us a donation.
How about that?
So.
Well, that says something about your leadership. And let me thank you very much for that leadership, Stan. I'm certainly appreciating. We need you more than ever in these times of troubles and
it's our
pandemic.
Mission.
And so, yeah,
it's our mission. It's what we do. It's what we live for.
Well, that's fantastic to hear. So I'd like to thank you again for joining us. I'd like to thank Chef Andrea, certainly for hosting us and providing all this delicious food. And until next week, ladies and gentlemen, keep lifting that community spirit. Cheers.
Salute.
Salute. All right.
Hi, I am Megan from Andrea's restaurant in here in Metairie, Louisiana. I will be making you an Amaro Andrea. I'm taking 1.5 ounces of the Carpano. One and a half ounces of the Amaro. A 1/2 ounce of the Fernet. Two dashes of the Peychaud's bitters. Two dashes of the Angostura bitters. Slice of an orange, put it into my jigger. A mint leaf, and then I muddle. Add ice. Strain into a cold martini glass. Garnish with a twist. And here you are.
All right, my name is Chris. I'm here at Andrea's in Metairie. Today we're gonna be making the Disaronno Sour. Start with 1.5 ounce Disaronno liqueur, Italy's favorite. Then we're gonna do 1 ounce of simple syrup. Fresh juice of a lemon, 1/2 of a lemon. Ice in our strainer, shake. Take a rocks glass, fill halfway with ice, and then we're gonna strain over fresh ice. Beautiful. Garnish with a cherry. There you go, Disaronno Sour.